Hi, I'm Jay.
And I'm John.
And we're Bucket List Travellers.
And today we're taking you on a walking tour of Madrid, Spain. We're starting our Madrid Christmas walking tour at Plaza de Canaleyes.
In front of us, you've got that building there with the, I think it's a cat kind of sign on the top of it. And that is Galerías Canaleyes, which is a luxury shopping center. It has over 40 brands of fashion, jewelry, perfume, and accessory stalls, as well as an upmarket food hall, and that includes some Michelin star rated restaurants as well.
It's a high-end shopping and culinary experience, I believe. And this building right in front of us that you see now, that has a very famous candy shop called Violetas. Legend has it that a previous king, King Alfonso the 13th, bought these Violetas candies for both his wife, the queen, and his lover.
Ooh.
That's a bit raunchy.
A bit
controversial.
So they must be pretty good quality candies if he was giving it to the loved ones in his life.
Yeah, that's right. In our walking tour today, we're going to take you through the historical center. So we're walking towards Sol, or the Puerta de Sol, which is like
the center of Madrid.
Yeah, essentially the center of Madrid. And then we're going to walk to the Teatro Real, and then finally the Royal Palace.
Yeah, so Madrid is a really beautiful place to come, and it really lights up over Christmas time. You can see there's a lot of decorations at night. This looks particularly good, and we will show you some clips that we took at night as well. It's a really lovely place, lots of atmosphere, heaps of people as well.
Yeah, so when we were filming this, it was early December, and there are a few public holidays around this time. And now we're entering the Puerta del Sol, the main center of Madrid.
Yeah, so this is the main town square, and it was named after a wall of a city gate that faced the east and had a depiction of the rising sun on it. So Puerta del Sol means gate of the sun, and that's where the name of this square came from. So this is actually kilometer zero of Spain. So all of the roads in Spain radiate out from this point. So you could say, like the sun being the center of the universe, Puerta del Sol is the center of Spain.
This big red billboard off to our right is about Casa de Papel, which is a very popular and big Netflix series.
Yeah, so you might know it as Money Heist. It's an action thriller. We love it.
Madrid really lights up at night, especially around Christmas, and Puerta del Sol is no exception.
Yeah, I love that massive Christmas tree. It's such a focal point of the square. We don't generally go out at night too much when we travel, but we made an exception for Spain and for Madrid in particular, because the nightlife here is really good. We felt really safe as well. Lots of people around, and it's just a lively, vibrant atmosphere. It's really great. On top of that building in front of us is an iconic sign for Tio Pepe Sherry. So Tio means uncle, so it's Uncle Pepe's sherry. And ads for this sherry have been in the square since 1936. Over the course of the last almost century, there's been civil war, there's been changes of government, but it has still remained through all of this time.
This iconic red and white building in front of us is the Royal House of the Post Office, or in Spanish, Real Casa de Correos. It's not currently the post office, it's now just a local government building.
But on top of that building is a clock tower, and this clock tower is a focal point for the New Year's celebrations in Madrid, and specifically the 12 grapes ritual. This ritual started back in the 1800s, and it was originally a clever marketing way of selling more grapes after a big bumper season. So local vine growers spread this custom of eating one grape for each strike of the clock at midnight on New Year's Eve as a ritual for good luck. And quite a clever marketing play, I think. It kind of reminds me of the fact that the modern day image of Santa was created by Coca-Cola to sell more Coke. We really enjoyed Madrid at Christmas time. We're originally from Australia, so it's really special for us to be somewhere in Christmas where it's like nice and cold, and it feels like really Christmassy, like what you'd see in TV.
Yeah, there's a real vibe in Madrid during Christmas time, like having lots of people around. There are Christmas markets that you can go to at night. It's really cool, and it's so different to Australia. So we're used to having Christmas during summertime. That has a very different vibe. It's very cool, but a different vibe.
Yeah, and I feel like you're always marketed this winter Christmas. So it's great to be able to experience it for ourselves and to have like hot chocolate and churros. And yeah, going to European Christmas markets. All the shops around here are great for looking if you're wanting to get some Christmas shopping done while you're in Madrid. It's a really lovely place to be over Christmas time in particular, but throughout the year, it's just a beautiful city.
And you will see, just on this street, it is a pedestrian street, but there are a few cross streets that cars still go over.
So just keep your wits about you.
Yeah, that's it. Off to our left here is the Church of St. Genesius, or San Ginés. So this is one of the oldest churches in Madrid. And references to it appear in documents dating all the way back to the 9th century. It's not in its original form. It was rebuilt largely in the 1600s to what you can see right now.
So it's still really old, but beautiful church. So a great landmark to visit in Madrid.
And another interesting fact is that St. Genesius is the patron saint of notaries and secretaries. So there really is a patron saint for everything. We're about halfway through our Christmas walking tour of Madrid. We hope you're enjoying it so far. If you are, make sure you hit that like button because it really helps our channel. And if you want to see more videos like this, we have plenty of walking tours as well as other travel and food videos from all around the world. So make sure you subscribe.
The street we're on at the moment is Calle del Arenal, and this is a very popular shopping street in Madrid. So other things to do in Madrid include definitely eating. Make sure you eat all the food. Spanish food is just brilliant. I particularly love bocadillos. What else do we love?
Oh yeah, so there's so much
croquetas,
patatas bravas. It's just all the different tapas. I really like tapas, where you can get a lot of little foods of everything.
Yeah, just the variety of food in Spain is just brilliant, and yeah, just so tasty and pretty affordable as well, don't you think?
Oh yeah, yeah. So I think during the day we could find lunchtime meals, like three-course meals, for 15 euros or less, which is really handy. There's 100 Montaditos, which is a really cool chain restaurant that has all these 1 euro and 2 euro deals.
Especially on Wednesdays and Sundays, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ah, so good. So if you want cheap eats in Spain, definitely go to 100 Montaditos.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
Really nice.
We have another big town square here. This is Plaza of Isabel II. And you can see a very large building in front of us.
Yeah, so that's the Teatro Real, so the Royal Theatre. So this theatre was built 1818, and it's known as one of the great theatres in Europe. So this area is also really pretty at night. There's a big Christmas tree, and there are a couple of night food markets off to the right there. It's a really cool atmosphere as well.
And if you're interested in seeing more of Madrid at night, we do have a full Madrid night walking tour. So check that out on our channel. If you're interested in visiting Madrid, we have some Spanish travel tips for you. So Madrid is a very walkable city, and we love that about Madrid. So we managed to get around really easily on foot.
We stayed on one side of the historical center, and we walked everywhere. If walking's not for you, there is a connected subway that takes you all through the different parts of the historical center and beyond.
Yeah, and you can see like there's rental bikes if you want to get around by bike. They're pretty easy to come by, or electric scooters. It's really easy to get around. Another thing I love about Madrid is all the museums that the city has.
And art galleries.
And art galleries. Yeah, it's just a real center of culture and art.
And another handy Madrid travel tip for you is that most of the museums and art galleries offer free admission after usually around 6 p.m. at night. So you can get to those exhibitions for free. It's awesome. Now, you also need to book ahead. So make sure you book a day or two ahead, because, you know, those free tickets are very popular.
Yeah, so it's usually the last couple of hours of opening, and I think sometimes on Sundays at free days as well.
It just depends on the
check with the particular site that you want to visit. So you can see there's just all these beautiful buildings around. The city really has some stunning architecture as well. So it's just a really beautiful city to visit because it's just stunning from every angle.
Yeah, it's such a beautiful city. Beautiful historic buildings, very colourful, a lot of green spaces as well.
Yeah, we love all the beautiful sprawling parks and gardens throughout the city. It's a really lovely place to wander around. I love how the roads are quite wide and walkable as well. Lots of pavements to go down.
Yeah, and pedestrian-only roads as well in the historical centre. That makes it really handy.
Yeah, it's a beautiful city.
Yeah. Now we're entering the Plaza de Oriente. So it's a big gardens just in front of the Royal Palace. It's a really pretty area. And the plaza has 44 statues of Spanish kings from the medieval times.
Yeah, so you can see in front of us, there's a statue of Felipe IV, and he's riding a horse that has both feet up. So we've come across this code before about military horse statues like this, and it relates to the position of the horse's legs in the statue. So basically what the code says is that if there's two hooves up, like in this statue, then the rider perished in battle. If there's one hoof up, it means he was wounded in battle. And if all four hooves are on the ground, then he died elsewhere. He managed to survive the battle unscathed. So we think this is just an urban legend. It doesn't necessarily get followed for every single statue. So for this statue, we haven't heard any records of Felipe IV dying in battle.
Yeah, I couldn't find anything in the literature alluding to that. So I think this myth is probably busted in this instance anyway.
Which is a shame because it sounds like an interesting code and it seems plausible. Unsurprisingly, one of the most impressive landmarks in Madrid is the Royal Palace of Madrid, and you can see that right in front of us.
The Royal Palace of Madrid is the official residence of the Spanish royal family at the city of Madrid. Now, it's my understanding that they've chosen not to live here. They live at a palace in another city.
So this is only used for state ceremonies.
Yes. So it's the largest royal palace in Europe, and as you can see, it looks pretty massive. It's got 3,418 rooms, so that's a very big palace.
And if you want to visit it yourself, it is open to the public, except when there are state functions on. Now, it is so large that only a selection of the rooms are open at any one time, and they change which rooms are open every few months. So if you do want to visit the Royal Palace of Madrid, the admission fee is 13 euro. And if you come on certain days, you might be lucky and get in for free.
So the palace is on the site of a bygone Muslim era fortress, which was constructed by Emir Muhammad I of Cordoba. And this original fortress was constructed way back in the 9th century. And the palace has undergone many renovations and rebuilds in the years since. So construction of the current palace spanned the years between 1738 to 1755, and that was after the old palace was destroyed by fire on Christmas Eve of 1734.
That's quite a sad little Christmas present for them, I'm
sure.
Yeah,
that really sucks, doesn't it? We're now entering the square of the Almudena Cathedral, which just faces the palace.
Yeah, so this cathedral started being built in 1878 and it didn't finish until 1992, so over a century later. Now, the explanation for this was that construction was interrupted by the Spanish Civil War, and so the site lay abandoned until the 1950s. This is a beautiful building. It's got a grey and white exterior, and it was funded by King Alfonso XII to house the remains of his wife, Mercedes of Orleans.
So what I find really fascinating is that Madrid, the capital of Spain, had no cathedral for over 400 years since the capital status was transferred from the old capital of Toledo until this cathedral was built.
And this was despite the fact that over this time, Spain was going around the world building cities in its colonies and creating cathedrals for those cities. And yet in its own capital, it had no cathedral.
So after you've had a look at the Almudena Cathedral and the Royal Palace of Madrid, make sure you keep walking towards the lookout point where you oversee the countryside house park or Casa de Campo.
This sprawling park is the largest public park in Madrid, and I love the views from this viewpoint up here. So this park was previously used exclusively for the royal family and nobility for hunting purposes, and it was opened to the public in 1931 and is now a public park.
We hope you've enjoyed our Christmas walking tour of Madrid, Spain.
And whatever you're doing this holiday season, we wish you all the best from Bucket List Travellers.
See you next time.